Hey everybody, this is Alex Merced from alexmercedcoder.com, and in this video what I am doing is going to try to show you different approaches to creating your functions, depending on sort of basically how to think through creating your functions. So first, let's create a scenario. What we're going to do is we're going to have two fighters. So we'll have fighter one, and let's make that a const. Const fighter one equals an object name Ryu, and we'll say life is 100, strength is 20, and then we'll just do another fight that's exactly the same. Save. This will be fighter 2, and this will be Ken. So if you've played Street Fighter, you know who these characters are. Okay, cool. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to create a function that allows one to attack the other. There's a couple different approaches I can take to this. So first we'll take the approach that, and then let me actually spell strength right. So the first approach I would take, or the first approach we'll cover, is adding a method. Okay? Adding a method. Now how would I do that? So a method means a function on the object itself. So if I wanted to do that, I would just do something like this. So I'll say, okay, I'll say attack. And attack is gonna equal a function. And in this case, I'm gonna wanna, when I'm doing something like this where I have fighters and I'm gonna need to refer to their properties, I'm gonna wanna use a function like this with the function keyword, so that way I can use the this keyword. The this keyword does not work with arrow functions, okay? So you run into other issues, or you run into, basically with arrow functions, the this keyword's kinda off limits unless it's in a class. Let's just put it that way. Okay, so function. And then basically we'll say, I wanna use this fighter's strength, so we'll say, and then we need to pass in the other fighter, so we'll say the enemy, so we'll refer to that as the enemy. We'll pass in the opposing figure, and we'll just keep it real simple. We'll just say, and since I'm passing in an object is passed by reference, so I don't necessarily need to return a value here, because technically any changes I make to the object will be reflected in the object. Okay, always kind of think about, what am I putting into this function? If I'm putting it in an object or an array, again, it passes by reference. Versus if I put in a number, a Boolean, or a string, it passes in by a copy. So then I need to return the new version of it and assign it to the variable, or assign it to a new variable to get that value back. So function, enemy. So let's say here, we're gonna just say the enemies dot life, okay, because we imagine, and again, you have to kind of think through what you're passing in. I'm passing in this fighter who has a life property, so we're gonna say that the enemy's life equals whatever the enemy's life is currently. Actually, let's make it even easier. We'll do minus equals, so that way it just subtracts it, because basically what minus equal means, it means subtract the next number from the number before it. So, and we'll say from this dot strength. So it'll subtract the enemy's life by the strength of Ryu. Okay, and then I can, and we'll just show that that works real quick. Okay, and then we'll go down here, and we'll just say fighter one dot attack fighter two. And then we'll just console log both fighters. Console.log fighter one, fighter two. And we'll see that even though I never returned a value, so notice that this function doesn't return a value. So if I were to console log this function, I'm gonna get undefined because it doesn't return a value. When you console log a function, you only get back whatever the value is returned. Doesn't mean it didn't do anything though. The function still mutated the object, meaning you changed the data. So I always get, and again, when you change data outside of your return value, that's referred to as a side effect. So I still have side effects going on. Okay, so the change to Fighter2's life is a side effect of the function, not the result of the function. There is no result of the function. There's no return value. Okay, so you see here, the function returned undefined because I never returned a value. But if I take a look at Ken, see Ken's life went down to 80 from 100 because he was hit by Ryu. So the function still had its effect. So you got to be careful. What does your function do? Does it return a value? Does it cause side effects? Because that's going to change how I test the function. So me console logging the result of the function was useless. This is not going to test anything because this function doesn't return a value. Okay, but it does alter the object. So console logging the objects can show me, did it have the right effect? Okay, so that's one approach to doing this. Okay, let's take a different approach. What if I decided I didn't want to use a method, I just want to use an external function? Okay. What I could do is I could do const attack. Okay, and then that equals, in this case, I don't need the use of this keyword because I'm going to pass in the objects as arguments. So I'm going to say, we'll say fighter one, so F1 and F2 as our parameters. Gets passed into this function. And I'll just write the same logic. So also just say F2.life, so Ken's life, will be minus equals F1.strength. So long as I pass in objects with the right properties, this function will do literally the exact same thing as the method did. Okay. Now, pros and cons, depending on how you create your objects. So if I'm just creating single objects like this, and I define methods and I'm defining the same method on each object, it takes up more memory because each object is going to have a separate copy of that function. This is where classes become really useful, because then you're creating sort of this prototype object and all those functions, all those methods are on the class that it refers to. So in that case, you're not necessarily making, every time you make a new instance of the class, you're not necessarily making a new copy of the function. But when you do make a new copy of the function, so if I do define it as a property of the individual object, not of a prototype, it does run faster because it's much quicker to find that property that's inside that object instead of having to keep going to all these reference objects. So that's just something to consider if you're going to go the method route, meaning adding the function to the object. Even though I didn't really talk about class as much in this video. Okay, so F2, life, F1, strength, so it ends up having the same result. So if I do this, if I do attack, but see, in this case, I'm not calling attack as a method of the object, so I'm not doing like fighter1.attack, I'm doing just attack, then I pass in fighter1, and I pass in fighter2. Now again, this function doesn't return a value. So if I console log the function, I'm still going to get undefined. But that's fine. I'm not looking for it to return a value. I don't need it to. Since the objects are passed by reference, just doing this is going to alter any objects I pass in. So if, just to kind of show you that's the case, console.log fighter1, fighter2. Save. Now if I run this code, see, I get the same thing. Undefined for this line here, because again, the function doesn't return any value, so of course it's going to show up as undefined because there's nothing to show for it. But the function did do what I wanted to do. See, Ken's life has dropped down to 80 again because I still have the side effect of the change in the value's properties. Okay, so this works. This is one way to write a function. This is a function that mutates data. Now there's a whole school of thought called functional programming that's like, the problem with this is like, you get confused with how to test it, because if it's not returning a value, then am I testing the return value? And then how do I know what the side effects are? So functional programming just says, you know what, put information in, old information in, new information out, no side effects. So if I were to take that approach with this, how would I do that? So we'll change this a little bit. Okay, what I would do if I wanted to make sure that there's no side effects, well, here's the thing, the object gets passed in as reference. So the first thing I'm gonna wanna do is create a copy of each object that's a separate object. So we'll just put, we'll put RealFighter1 equals a new object that's just F1 spread out. Because what this does, it copies F1, which is Fighter1, but it makes it a separate object. So when I edit that one, it won't automatically edit the original. Okay, and then I'll do RF2 equals RF, well, that's equals F2 spread out. Okay, so there, now I have my two copies of my fighters. Okay, they're separate copies, so when I edit them, it doesn't edit the original. Okay, so then I don't have to worry about any side effects. Now what I want to do is get the new life of, so I want to do the damage. So I'm going to, so instead I'm going to return the new life of the resulting fighter. So I'm going to say, hey, you know what? The result should be the second fighter, because that's Ken, rf2.life minus equals, let's see, this keeps adding that E in there, rf1.strength. Okay, so so now we do have a return value. Okay, so this function, just running it itself, does not alter the two objects. So now when I run this thing, we are going to get a return value, so this won't be undefined anymore, but we'll notice that neither of the two objects have changed, because the function itself doesn't mutate the object. So let me run that, save. Okay, see, so I know that the new life for Ken should be 80, but his life is still 100, because the function doesn't mutate it. It does give me the new life, so that means I need to go back and do something with it. So technically what I want to do is, so I'll get rid of this console log here for a moment, because what I need to do is change the fighter's life outside. So I go fighter2.life equals attack, fighter1, fighter2. Okay, now that has the same effect. Okay, let's see what it says. Unexpected token. Oh, there's an extra parenthesis here. Save. Cool, 80. So now it did change Ken's life, because what happens is that this function gave me back 80, which should be new Ken's life, and I just reassigned Ken's life, and now Ken's life has changed. So that's another approach. So it's a little, again, a little bit extra work, because see, this function's only doing one thing. But here's a nice thing about this. I know that anything I put in when I take this approach, anything I put in is not going to get changed. So I don't have to worry about it changing and thinking about how it's going to affect other things. And I know only one thing is supposed to come out, and that is the new life of the character that was attacked. So how I use it is up to me, but I know I'm getting that back. And then, so it makes it easier to test. Now I could console log to see if this is giving me back the right value. And I know that it only does one thing. And that's the best thing to do. Make sure that each function only does one thing, that it takes whatever input it needs to get the right output. And that output is the return value. And there's only one return value. Okay, now there might be a situation where you need to return more than one value. So maybe this function might do a lot of things to Ken. So then maybe the smart thing would have not been to do this instead. You know, so basically still do this. Okay, make any other changes I need to do both at the end. And at the end, return an array with both objects. Okay, I could do this. I could do, okay, so at the end, it just gives me back RF1 and RF2. So I get back the changed versions of these. And let me actually make these lets so I can reassign them. Let. Let me give this a shot. I have a feeling I might. Well, let's give this a shot. I think this should work. So I'm going to use destructuring, although usually destructuring creates a new variable. So we'll see if I don't run into an issue here when I do this. But since I'm using variables that already exist, fighter1 and fighter2. Since they already exist, I don't need to put const, let, or var here because I've already initialized them. And using destructuring, since this function now returns this array, I can destructure the new version of the object and just sit there and say, hey, when this comes in, this array gets destructured, RF1 goes into fighter1, RF2 goes into fighter2, and I should still get the same effect. Let's test this out. And then this is kind of how you would, like, if you need more than one thing coming out of the function, you can put it in an array, you can put it in an object of arrays. You know, you can send a more complex data structure so that way you can send back more than one piece of data if you need to. Okay, so again, you can either send back an object with your data, an array with your data. In this case, I sent an array of two objects, which are just a new version of the two objects I put in. Okay, and then you see, I end up in the right place. Because just what I'm doing is I'm just basically reassigning the two objects. So I'm not necessarily mutating or changing the old object. I'm passing them into the function. The function does what it's supposed to do and returns me a new version of both objects with all the changes. And then I just reassign them. This would be sort of a more functional programming approach. It seems a little bit more verbose, creating all these objects over and over again, even just for slight changes. But the idea is that it makes it more predictable because, you know, any changes, there's no changes, there's just a new object, and I can test the function to see if the object came out the way it was supposed to. Okay, I don't have to necessarily, I could assign it to a new variable if I wanted to. What I do from there is up to me. Okay, so hopefully this got you thinking about how you create your functions. So again, things you want to consider is like, do I want to use this function as a method of an object? Do I want to use this function? Do I want this function to mutate what I pass in? So if I'm passing in an object or array, do I want them to be mutatable? If not, then maybe I should do something like this to create a copy of them. So that way I'm not mutating the original, but a copy. Think, hey, does this function just do one thing and give me back one value? Then I should be returning that value at the end. Especially if you don't want it to mutate, because if you don't want it to mutate data, the only thing it can do is give you back something that you decide what to do with afterwards. Okay, but remember the difference between what happens when you return a value versus not return a value. Okay, so again, when I didn't return a value, even though the function did what I wanted mutation-wise, the function returns undefined. So again, always just think through, what is my function doing? Just run it. Once you've written it, read it back to yourself line by line and think through what you've done. So, yeah, cool. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that. My name is Alex Merced from alexmercedcoder.com. Check out devnursery.com. Join the Slack community over there. And make sure to head over to devnursery.com. Find some cool videos and a Slack channel, Slack community to join. And meet other developers. Yay! See you guys later.